Good afternoon, everybody. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. I've got a confession. I can resist everything except Danish cake. Just before, this is the worst thing that can happen to a speaker. You're really like anticipating, getting excited. The adrenaline is rushing. And then somebody offers you a delicious Danish cake. So it's there, and I do my very best to resist temptation for the next 45 minutes. Can everybody hear me okay at the back? Okay, fantastic. So I'm very happy to be back in Copenhagen. I arrived here last night from Doha, and literally I stood outside the airport at Doha for about 5 minutes, and that's why I'm tanned. It was like 45 degrees. This morning I got on a bicycle in Copenhagen. That's fantastic. Cycling along, I ended up having a race with somebody else. Yeah, it got really competitive. And he beat me, he did beat me. So today, this afternoon, I want to talk to you about how to lead in the age of disruption. And what do I mean by that? I mean embracing change, and responding to change, learning from change, anticipating change, and exploiting change as an opportunity. The problem, a few people make change happen, a lot of people wait for change to happen, and some people wake up in the morning, they look out the window, and they say, hey, what happened? Mm-hmm. It's important that you're not in that box. Today I want to take you on a journey into the hearts and minds of risk takers, pioneers and visionaries who change ahead of change. And I'm going to give you some new insights into the three most important mindsets you need to amplify in order to not just survive, but thrive in this new reality. To get started, we're going to do an experiment. And for this, you need to face a partner, a neighbor. So get into pairs, please. If you're sitting by yourself, get into pairs. There's no physical contact in this experiment, don't worry. It's not a speed dating game. There's no doubt that change management is a social process. A lot of change efforts are very left brain, and that's one of the problems. We are born creative, and then we're educated to not be creative, and by the time we finish business school, we're definitely not creative. And there's no doubt that in this age of disruption, what I mean by that is exponential change. That means three things: the significance of change, the scale of change, and the scope of change. Exponential. Well, let me give you an example of that. It took 8,000 years to reach the industrial age. From there, it took 120 years to get the light bulb. From there, 90 years to the moon landing. From there, 22 years to the internet. And then we sequenced the human genome. And that took 13 years and a cost of $2.7 billion. Today, you can sequence a human genome in less than 72 hours and less than $1,000. This is exponential change. According to Dr. Mike Lee, a futurist at the World Economic Forum, the next double century will see up to 150 breakthroughs on par with the steam engine, airplane, and antibiotics. And even if we're pessimistic about that, there's no doubt that the difference now, disruption's always been around, by the way, from the wheel to abacus to the gunpowder to the steam engine to the telegraph, it's always been with us. What's different now is the speed and scalability. Just a couple of weeks ago, I had some email exchanges with one of your fellow nationals. He's Danish. His name is Dennis Mortensen. He's a serial entrepreneur. He lives in New York now. And he runs an AI company, artificial intelligence. And I should have guessed that he was going to play a trick on me. He said to me, I'm going to put my PA in touch with you. Her name's Amy Ingram. Think about that name for a moment. So I started to get emails from Amy. And these emails were so sophisticated, so normal, that I was having a normal conversation with Amy. It turned out that Amy wasn't real. Amy is AI, and this is happening right now. I felt so silly to begin with, but I also felt excited because I realized that science fiction is now becoming science fact. And what drives Dennis Mortensen is, a couple of years ago, he organized himself over 1,000 meetings in 1 year. It drove him mad. And then he had to reorganize 600 of those. So he set up a business called X.AI. You should check it out. You can use Amy for free. She'll organize up to 5 meetings for you a month. And then you go into subscription. Check it out for yourself, X.AI. When I met Dennis, he said we spend over 10, we focus on over 10 billion meetings a year, a lot of which waste our time and stops us from making change. Okay, so the experiment. Please face each other. No death stares. Okay, change is a social process. It's left brain and right brain. What I'd like you to do, I'd like one person from each pair to be an observer. And this is an easy role. So please decide who will be the observer in your pairs.
Very diplomatic.
No arguments. Excellent. The role of the observer is to observe carefully what your colleague does when I give them the instruction. So observe or watch carefully. The other person, I'd like you now, without thinking, use a finger, not a pen, draw the capital letter E on your forehead. Go. Do it again. Make sure you don't rush. Now, swap roles, so the other person do it. And remember, how do they do the E? How do they draw the E? Okay, so I'd like to give you some context, because this is a really critical takeaway today, if you want to change faster and better. Professor Adam Galinsky, I met Professor Adam Galinsky at Columbia Business School. He is a global expert on organizational psychology. And he has spent the last 10 years looking at the impact of power and success on our ability to change and on our ability to look at other people's perspectives. Professor Adam Galinsky discovered that when you are a high power group, and what that means is the more expertise you have, the more successful you are, the more likely it is that you disregard other people's opinions. The French have a word for this, déformation professionnelle. It's your blind spot. What Professor Adam Galinsky discovered, he had two groups. In group one, they were a low power group, so they had lower status. In group two, he had a high power group. The high power group were 3 times more likely to draw an E, which was self-facing. They literally looked at the E from their own perspective and made the E self-facing. They looked at it from their own perspective. The lower power group tended to draw an E so that the other person could read it. We can see the results here. What that actually means, this is called the success paradox. We see it again and again and again. We are, as Daniel Kahneman, psychologist, says, we are blind to our own blindness. 2 of the worst things that can happen to your business. 1, you run out of cash. 2, you're very successful. The more successful you are, the more likely it is that you'll defend and preserve the status quo of what you do far longer than you should. You'll change later rather than sooner. And so a question that I want to answer today is, how do you change ahead of change? How do you embrace the waves of disruption and leverage it as an opportunity? What do you need to change in order to embrace change and not just survive, but thrive in this new reality? So let's do a deep dive.
It's not you.
This is time for a cake break.
Yes. It's not a baby's trick.
Yes. Is that better?
Yeah.
I sound like Barry White now. It's a cake and everything. I love it. So, okay, so the first learning point is success and power can mean that you listen more to your own perspective than listening to other perspectives. The classic example is a guy called Steve Sasson. You may have heard of him. He was an engineer at Kodak. He invented the first digital camera in 1975. But the board of Kodak did not want to disrupt their existing business model, which was making a lot of money. So let's look at this in more detail. Recently I went to Facebook. How many of you use Facebook? Yeah, I mean, in some ways it's a bit of a nightmare, isn't it? It's like just become like a second arm, a third arm. What's interesting about this visit is that when you arrive at the headquarters of Facebook, there's the iconic thumbs up. But on the back of the sign, it's really clever. Well, Zuckerberg, I don't know if Zuckerberg did this with intention or accidentally. I'm sure he did it by design. But on the back of the sign is the old Sun Microsystems logo. Now, Sun was once a $200 billion company. Most talented minds in business, a strong brand, strong talent, processes, Six Sigma, change management experts. But they refused to change before they needed to. They suffered from change blindness. They committed to a business model far longer than they should have. And the fact is that companies that you admire around the world are dying younger and younger. According to McKinsey, the average lifespan of a company now has dropped from 50 years to less than 15. And over the next 10 years, we're looking at another 40% death rate from contraction or mergers and acquisitions, or simply companies being replaced and displaced. And this is the essence of disruption. It's a new way of thinking, a new way of doing. It's going to rethink and rewrite how you do business. So how do we avoid becoming the next Sun Microsystems? What do you need to do today to accelerate change and make it part of your culture? Satya Nadella at Microsoft, an interesting individual, he talks about the difference between a know-it-all culture and a learn-it-all culture. His mission at Microsoft, the old mission from Steve Ballmer, was put a desktop computer in every office and home in the world. If they'd carried on with that vision, clearly they'd become another Sun Microsystems. But Satya Nadella, who is a change maker, has come into the business and revitalized it. This is the difference between being a day one company and a day two company. I want you to think about that. A day one company means that you're always experimenting, taking intelligent risks, testing out new ideas. You're innovating, you're inventing. A day two company is business as usual. Business as usual. Most companies are day two companies, or they become day two companies. To remain a day one company, you have to think like a startup. You have to have the heart and spirit of a startup. Startups are great at scaling quickly. You also have to use the resources of a big corporate, but it's that agility to think and act like a startup and to continue to reinvent yourself before you need to. Everyone's talking about disruption. It's become one of those buzzwords. And the danger of that is you lose the specificity. You lose the meaning. I recently met a guy in Silicon Valley. I asked him what his job title was. And it wasn't even being sarcastic. He said to me, director of disruption. I mean, it was about as popular as saying you're a director of death. I mean, I couldn't believe it, but yeah, he was a director of disruption. So, disruption, what does it mean? I think it means exponential change, as I said, and that is defined by three dimensions. One, the scale of change, the scope of change, and the significance. Change. disruptions happening everywhere. So it's not just organisational, it's political as well. We've got a reality TV star who's now the president of the US. I know, do you want some cake? This is now, I think it's a Swedish word, fika time. Yes. We've got a battery innovation company. Repeat that, a battery company that's now got the biggest market cap in the car industry, 51 billion. GM is 50 billion. And Ford, with over 100-year history, 45 billion. By the way, GM made a profit of over 15 billion last year, and Tesla made a loss of $675,000. But it's still valued multiples higher because the market thinks that that is the future. And Elon Musk is a great example of a change maker. He thinks big, but he also acts quickly. So we can see that disruption is happening everywhere. It's how we think, it's what we do. It's turning business models upside down. It's destroying legacy value. But it's not just negative, it's also positive. We've got Amazon, e-commerce cloud services company, winning 3 Oscars this year. Again, an example of the old rules don't apply anymore. Before you could protect yourself with economies of scale, that no longer applies. Now any company can attack your business model. CEOs around the world are sweating in their boardrooms. Data is the new oil. Even my new niece, I call her my CTO, Child Technology Officer. Most families have one. They're great at connecting the iPhone to the iPad. She even thinks that the TV is a giant iPad. Our children in the next 5 years, the next billion digital natives are about to start entering the workforce. So again, massive organisational change because they want to be led and managed in a completely different way to how you were led and managed in your careers. So, how do we reconcile these forces? How do we turn these forces into opportunities? Let's jump online and do a 30-second test. For this, you need to go to slido.com with your mobile. So, jump onto slido.com. Put in hashtag 5676. So slido.com, hashtag 5676 is your code. And I want you to answer one question. We're going to do a live poll. Your company, so Mike, the question I want you to answer: my company embraces change and is ready to leverage disruption as an opportunity. Let's not overthink the semantics of this question. Go with your gut feel. My company embraces change and leverages it as an opportunity. We're getting some live results in here. Now I can have my cake. By the way, this is a great tool to use your own change management efforts. When you're looking to assess the receptivity of change or influence change or have a courageous conversation about change, this is a tool in your toolkit that can help start a conversation about change within your organization. So you can use this as a practical tool as well. How are we doing then with the results? So far, still moving, still in motion. But, you know, that's pretty positive. When I do this around the world, the results are very different. So each culture will have a change appetite, a risk-taking appetite as well. There's a great app developed at Cambridge University called Culture GPS. And it will help you identify not just your cultural intelligence, but help identify change styles of different cultures. Culture GPS is an app that you can download for free. Okay, so we've got some results here, And it's positive to see that the majority have a relative level of confidence. But we can see, and this is replicated around the world, that more can be done. More can be done in terms of a structure and a clarity of purpose around what is disruption. Do we have an aligned view of disruption at a leadership level? Do we understand how to embrace disruption and leverage it and get value from it? Do we have the right capabilities in place? For example, Jeff Bezos, he's another day one company as opposed to a day two company. He talks about four strategies which are really great for accelerating change. One, be obsessed with your customers or users. Be obsessed with them. Two, avoid proxies. What I mean by that is, do the processes control you, or you control the processes? Very easy when you become a grown-up company to drown and become a prisoner to process. So, be aware of proxies. Be obsessed with your users. Number three is embrace early trends quickly. So you need to have three types of focus here. Look outside of your business to look at trends, positive and negative, that you can now embrace or respond to. But you also need to have that inner focus and also be aware of those blind spots that you focus too much on your own perspective and you stop listening to what the outside world is saying. So, customer obsession, proxies, be aware of them because they can slow you down and kill a change management effort. Embrace trends early. And finally, number four, you need to be in a perpetual state of beta now. You know, this idea of we're a status quo business, you need to be working, validating your existing business model. So that's the execution side. Execution cultures are good when they're validating business models that work. But the problem now is you also need to be working on another business model to future-proof and avoid the first one becoming another sort of microsystems. So execution cultures, we need those, scaling, validating existing business models. But actually, if you're looking to build a culture of change, you need to incentivize risk, incentivize experimentation. Okay, so let's move on. Anybody know who this is? His name sounds like something out of a film. I'm not sure if it's his real name, but he calls himself Astro Teller. And on his business card, and this is no joke, he's actually British, but he grew up in the US, California, obviously. Astro Teller, captain of moonshots, he heads up the X department. It used to be called Google X, the moonshot factory. It's called a moonshot factory because it's about thinking bigger, 10 times bigger, to disrupt status quo thinking. The problems of today, the challenges of today, cannot be solved with yesterday's thinking. So you need to upgrade your mindset. And what that means is 10x thinking. An example of 10x thinking would be the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, which wants to wipe out malaria in 10 years. Another example would be Elon Musk's goal to put people on the planet within the next 10 years. They're big, audacious goals. That doesn't mean we still need to start small, though, experiment. What's interesting about this particular change maker is two things. One, to disrupt your business as usual hat, you need to think in a completely different way. And so what they do at Google X or X is they reward failure. It's really counterintuitive. Rather than just reward success, they've realized that people tend to keep focusing on defending the status quo or allocating energy and time to projects, which they know right at the outset aren't working. And they're much closer and know more about the project than you. So what they're trying to do here, which is instructive and we can learn from it, is if you want to accelerate change, you need to create psychological safety. People need to feel comfortable making errors, but not stigmatizing it as an error, that actually failure is not the opposite of success, it's a stepping stone to success. So I think it's a really interesting way, if you want to create a culture of change, not a status quo culture, you need to incentivize risk-taking, experimentation, create a culture of psychological safety where people can, they feel comfortable to speak up and have learnable lessons from failure. The point here is that when the rate of change, the rate of uncertainty is like this, you can afford to make more mistakes. And in fact, you should, as long as they're fail fast, fail cheap, and move on. What I recommend is that you use a methodology from the military, AAR. So after your change efforts, after action review, what did you intend to achieve? What really happened? And what were the lessons learned? Reid Hoffman at LinkedIn, he sold LinkedIn to Microsoft for $21 billion. But he, another really entrepreneurial change maker, he talks about learning loops. To accelerate change, you need to create fast learning loops. A learning loop means four things: observing, orienting, deciding, and acting. And actually, the teams and the companies with the fastest learning loops, observing, orienting, deciding, acting, are the ones that win in this new environment. The next tool of Google, which again is very powerful, is catalytic questioning. The saying is that questions are one half of wisdom, and often we underestimate the power of questions. The way this technique works, which you can use and test out, is that you pick a problem with your team, you then focus on generating only questions, as many as you can in a limited time, so for example 10 minutes, and generate questions, as many as you can. And then you look at those questions and pick two or three that disrupt status quo thinking, that disrupt the way that you look at the problem, that provide you with a fresh pair of eyes. Because in this age of disruption, you've got to adapt new mindsets and look at the world differently. It's no longer linear change. It's non-linear change. Your competition can come from anywhere, not just your industry. Another example of a change maker, Adobe. This is our Chief Strategist Officer, Mark Randall. Like most people, his biggest frustration was a lack of innovation. So he decided to do an experiment. He got rid of the innovation department. If you think about it, innovation is not a job title, it's not a department, it's not a status. It should be a set of winning behaviors that everybody in the company feels proud of and uses. Rather than have a department of innovation, he wanted to create a company of 10,000 innovators. What he says is, you can be an innovator, a follower, or out of business. So he created a really cool idea called Adobe Kickbox. And before I share that with you, I want to give you a short video. When I met Mark Randall, he said one of the biggest problems to change is that we're so left-brained. As I said, by the time we finish university, we're that left-brained. Everything's a process and a framework. The ability to be creative, to look at the world and make new connections is so much more difficult. We grow up and we celebrate left-brain thinking. But actually, in this age of disruption, you need to use both. Let's look at a short video of this problem in action. Feel free to sing along with it. Thank you. I'd love to carry on listening to it. So, one of the problems then is this left brain approach to change management, and actually there's a social intelligence side. You can create social norms. You can create social norms. you can create social norms with your teams. So, for example, at Adobe, what they did to create a company of 10,000 innovators to create a culture of change is that they rewarded risk and experimentation. They gave psychological safety to test ideas and to fail fast and move on. And they gave everybody a red box. In this red box, you've got a toolkit to change, a toolkit to be more innovative. The best part of this is that everybody in the company had a pre-approved credit card, pre-approved for $1,000. To prototype, to run experiments, and to find the next big idea. In the box, there's even a chocolate bar and a Starbucks credit, because obviously caffeine and chocolate is important for creativity. You can actually check this out. What Adobe have done very kindly is they've made it open source. If you go to kickboxadobe.com, you can download all the files that are in that box for free. You can create your own box. You can look at the process of creating a culture of change and accelerating it. It's a great practical tool to take away and have a look at off the back of today's talk. Kickboxadobe.com. So the second key message here is, do you have a culture of status quo or a culture of change? If you want to create a culture of change, you've got to involve everybody in the company. It's not just the department or somebody's job title. And you've got to fight this disease, which is we're all educated to be left brain, cynical, intellectual. And that is not going to help you thrive in this new world of disruption, where the speed of change is exponential. It's no longer about big or small. It's about fast or slow. For example, it took the telephone 75 years to reach 100 million users. It took WhatsApp 3 years, and the game Pokemon Go 3 weeks. The speed from 0 to 100 million users is becoming more and more compressed. So let's take a pause. The first mindset that I want you to think about is 10x thinking, so thinking 10 times bigger. The way to use that is, for example, if you have a process, a supply chain, most business people think about a 10% improvement, so they use incremental thinking. Most of us use incremental thinking instinctively, and we inherit this from school. How are we going to improve by 10%? How are we going to grow by 20%? 10x thinking is meant to disrupt that. The point is that you may not reach a 10x goal, you probably won't. But by aiming for that, you have to disrupt and challenge everything you know about that problem. Look at it in a completely different way. It's a bit like, you know, deja vu, where the unfamiliar seems familiar. What I want you to practice, and this is my own creation, is vu deja. Thank you. It's difficult to say. Vu deja, what that means is you need to make the familiar unfamiliar. You need to look at your processes, look at how you operate your business models and try and extract value and look at them in a different way. Vu déjà. So, takeaway number one, 10x thinking. Catalytic questioning. Takeaway number two, create a company of innovators. Create a culture of change where everybody is involved in the process. My final mindset is about resilience and courage. The Finnish call it sisu. It's like a Viking spirit. Tenacity, courage, and the ability to get back. When you're changing faster, when you're in a world of disruption, where your business models can turn upside down, you need to have more courage. Courage to manage upwards, to have tricky conversations with your bosses. Courage to take a risk, an intelligent risk. I'd like to introduce you to Jan Koum. How many of you use WhatsApp? Yeah. This is Jan, he's the co-founder of WhatsApp, a very interesting story of change and resilience. He was born in a little village just outside of Kiev, Ukraine. Came from a very poor family. His father was a teacher. This is during police surveillance times. Interestingly, that made Jan very paranoid about privacy, which was later, you know, as I think Danish philosopher said, Kierkegaard, you can only connect the dots looking backwards. So, picture the scene, Jan is 11 years old, his dad disappears, gets taken away by the police. He never sees his father again. His mother and Jan decide to move to San Jose, California. Life is difficult, so that's change number one, leaving the country. Interestingly, many entrepreneurs who are obviously role models for changing exponentially, often they have what's called a schema violation. It's a really interesting term. It's called the geography of genius. If you had to leave, if your life has been disrupted from an early age, an unintended consequence of that is more resourcefulness and creativity. And so Jan had to make one big change, leaving his country and losing his father. Now, Jan is 14, 15 years old, and his mother has to work 16 hours a day as a cleaner. After 3 years, she gets cancer. And you wonder how much bad luck can you have in life. It's a really aggressive form of cancer, and his mother passes away after 2 years. So big change number two, loss. Jan then started at university, and like a lot of entrepreneurs, he dropped out. But that's okay, because when you're an entrepreneur, and if you become successful, you then get honorary degrees. You get invited back, and you get multiple degrees without studying. It's quite clever. So Jan went to university, dropped out, and he got a job at Yahoo. And there, his luck started to change. On the second day, he met a guy called Brian. Brian is about 10 years older, and they became best friends. Not only that, but Brian became a mentor and a guide. And I think to change in this world of disruption, to lead yourself, to lead others, you need to surround yourself with multiple mentors. Who are your mentors right now? Have a think. Because you need multiple mentors to give you different perspectives. By the way, when I did that e-test with the CEO recently, he did an X. Yeah, seriously. So you have to be mindful of that. Now, Jan spent 10 years at Yahoo, and then he applied for jobs. In fact, both him and Brian applied for jobs at Facebook, at Twitter, and they got rejected. And in fact, there's a Twitter feed from Brian, which is in my book, which says, "Today I went for an interview with Facebook. Great company, wasn't to be." That was an expensive mistake for Facebook. They decided to take a vacation. And this is another important learning point. When you're that close to the problem, or the frustration in your company, it's very difficult to think differently. Most companies are designed to make you tired. I know this from personal experience, but from the carpets, to the air conditioning, to the height of the ceiling, you feel exhausted. When you leave the office to be creative, you know there's a problem. So I think there's no time today to go on this, but high-performing buildings, high-performing architects that create buildings and spaces that facilitate change and creativity are going to become very, very popular in the next 10 years. So these guys, they take a holiday, they go to South America, and that's during that time that Jan has this idea for what's up, which then becomes what's up. And like most ideas start as bad ideas. And for the first 3 years, Jan wanted to give up. But fortunately, he had that mentor, that guide to keep him focused. And he continued. And within 5 years, WhatsApp had reached over 100 million users. On Valentine's Day, February 14th, 2014, they get a call from Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook, and over cherry cake and coffee, they do a deal, and WhatsApp is acquired by Facebook for $19.5 billion. And they only have 55 employees. I hear they are hiring. There's a couple of lessons from this. One, in the age of disruption, you've got to make your own luck. How do you do that? Well, I think it requires tenacity. It's building chance encounters. So really being proactive for creating chance encounters. Building a culture of serendipity. How do you do that? Well, it's about stepping out of your world into other worlds. Make sure you've got a point of view about trends that excite you, but trends that also disturb you. Do something once a month or once a quarter that your future self will thank you for, that challenges your way of seeing the world. So that's lesson one, make your own luck. Lesson two is sometimes what you're doing now can't be understood until you look back 5 years down the line. And so uncertainty, volatility, complexity, ambiguity, all these disruptive forces, they create risk, but they also create opportunity. Finally, number three, practice 1 minute of daily courage. Every time you speak up in a meeting, challenge an assumption. Remember, most companies, every company is made up of a collection of assumptions. So what assumptions is your company applying? Most companies are still operating 20th century mindsets. What do I mean by that? Hierarchical, planning instead of experimenting. Profit instead of purpose. Efficiency instead of responsiveness. So ask yourself, are you operating a 20th century mindset or a 21st? We need to upgrade our mindsets for this age of disruption. What's my final takeaway? Three box thinking. You can apply this to yourself and your organization. Box one is about optimization, managing the present. And that's where most companies are comfortable. That's where the Sun Microsystems and the Kodak, the Blackberries, the Nokias, and many other companies are excellent. Doing what they know best, box one activity. And you've got to be good at that. That's all about execution culture. As we've seen though with Tim Cook and Apple recently, when you go from a culture of change and innovation to a culture of execution, there's not long before things start to go wrong. So, do box one really great, but also focus your change efforts on box two. Box two, and this is one of the most difficult boxes, to change, you need to decide what to stop doing. Old habits, old ways of thinking, old behaviors, old assumptions. What are you prepared to kill today? And that's really difficult because most companies aren't prepared to do that. They'll hold on to their success formula far longer than they should until it's too late. And when it's too late, you can't actually catch up again. So box two, I want you to use box two to think about what do we need to stop doing? Processes, procedures, assumptions, operating models, mindsets. Because you can't change unless you're prepared to let go and stop doing things. Something that we often forget with change. What are you prepared to let go and kill? Don't mean literally. Final box is about creating the future. That's the 10X, moonshot thinking. That's about planting seeds today. That's about iterating other business models. So three box activity to help you accelerate your change, manage the present, let go of the past, and also build the future. My final point is, are we ready to change ahead of change? And there is some urgency to this, and I don't want to depress you, but if we're lucky, we have 960 months to live. 960 months, you can get your calculator out. 960 months is 80 years of age, or 29,200 days to be exact. I know. Some of you are already going to quit your jobs, I can see. Like, right, I'm going to travel around the world. 960 months, 300 months of sleep. So we often accept the status quo in our lives and our businesses, and we forget to change. So I'd like to leave you with the final words of the original disruptor-in-chief, the late Steve Jobs. Your time is precious. Don't waste it living somebody else's life. Don't get trapped by dogma, which is living with the results of other people's thinking. Don't allow the noise of other people's voices to drown out your own inner voice. Most importantly, have the courage to listen to your own heart and intuition. It somehow already knows what you want to become. Everything else is secondary. Knowing that you're going to die is the single best way of avoiding the trap of thinking you have something to lose. There's no reason not to change and follow your heart. Hag det godt.